So this is the image of the report, a picture I made myself in Stockholm last week. And yeah, when talking about gig economy, yeah, of course you go to the most visible part, that is the food delivery and taxi. But of course, gig economy is much more than only that. First, a big thank you to the partners and sponsors of the research. In total, 8 different stakeholders were contributing in knowledge, but also in finance to do this research. So the UWV, the Dutch Employment Service, Young Ones, it's the gig platform, Seeds to Meet, it's a tech company, and also a really nice platform in Netherlands, the Ministry of Economic Affairs and Climate, JobTech Gig, which is part of the Swedish Employment Service, the A3, the European Trade Union Institute's Fresh Heads. It's a platform built and a giant company here in Netherlands, and FNV, the biggest labor union in Netherlands. And I really like this diversity of partners, because in the end, I think all questions on gig economy also needed to addressed collectively. And of course, a really big thank you to the organization of Reshaping Work, and of course, Giovanna and Ispren especially, but also the rest of the team, because I joined with them to organize this event, and I'm really happy on how they are supporting me in doing this all online. And of course, the Reshaping Onwards events are independently organized events under the umbrella and brand of Reshaping Work. So if you also want to do this, please also contact Giovanna for more information. I can really highly recommend working with them. So this is the agenda. First, I will start with some report results in a nutshell, in a 10-minute presentation. Then we have a nice contribution by Judith Kass about the questions, okay, does important reputation contribute to the hiring attention of clients? Because it's nice to take your data with you, but in the end, if it doesn't contribute to the power of the worker, it's worthless. So that's a really nice, good research we did also as a part of this project. Another research we also did as part of the project is the work that Jeroen Meijering is going to present about the question, what do platform workers want? Because I think in the platform work discussion, of the gig worker discussion, we're really good talking about gig workers, but not really good in talking with gig workers. And with this research, we did that. Then we have a expert panel with platform leaders and then also a Q&A. The expert panel is being led by Giovanna, and we have nice contributions from platform leaders from Glovo, from Meploy, and from Roamler. So it's also nice to hear from them how they look at the portability of data from their platforms. And then in the end, we have a sneak preview of the future plans. So it's, okay, so what's next in this topic on portability of reputation data for gig workers, and some closing remarks. And this is again a picture I made in Stockholm last week. First travel since 20 months, so that was nice. And I think also my last travel for the next coming months, thanks to COVID. Okay, first the positive news, of course. So the report results in a nutshell. Of course, there's quite a discussion on gig economy. Most of the times, discussions on gig economy are really on the food delivery or delivery and taxi. But of course, gig economy is much bigger than that. That's also why I also made this image, because I think the main things you can look at gig economy is, okay, what is the location? Is it a online gig or a on location gig? And how is the match being made? So is it a algorithm that makes a match, or is it the client that makes a match? I think it's really important. And this is the whole scope of the gig economy. There's lots of discussion, of course, on gig economy. So I think about fair pay, about transparency of algorithms, the worker, the legal status, discrimination, and also protection of the worker. But I think at the upside, also many people agree that platforms make it easier to enter the labor markets. So it's a fine first step, but what is the perspective? I think this data portability question can really contribute to that. Agreeing, okay, gig work is really flexible. It contributes to economic growth as well for worker as for the economy in a much broader sense of the word. It really gives autonomy, and also that the platform worker doesn't exist. So the same as the worker doesn't exist, also in gig economy, the platform worker does not exist. So then there's a challenge that platforms make it easier for people to enter labor markets. So it's a fine first step, but what then? And I think that's also one of the main issues in this discussion we have today. So there are quite some reports on data portability. So, okay, can we give this data to the worker? The only challenge in the most report is that there's quite, so it's really based on many assumptions. So the assumption that giving the worker this data will empower the position in labor markets and make it easier to multi-home, so work via more platforms, and also find work in the non-platform platform markets. But then nobody takes it into practice. And I think that's something that's really missing in the debates. And we're also going to address in this in this session then. So the portability of data. So what, why, how, and how? I think the why, that's also the part of the story of Judith. So I'm not going to touch on that. The why from the platform works perspective is also then on the work of Jeroen. We did together. So then we keep over. So what's the relevance of the type of data? What's the relevance of skills and who and how? So if you look at the type of data, there's a really strong focus on, also in the discussion I analyzed, on reputation data. So the ratings, so the stars, and also the written reviews, depending, of course, what kind of platform you're working via. But also, there's also lots of other data that has great value of the worker. So more objective data on transaction and skills could also be of great value of the worker. And then you can talk about, okay, what is it they started working via the platform? How many gigs did you do? What kind of sectors? What kind of clients? And also, last but not least, what skills did you use to perform your work? And if you zoom in more to the skills, because I have discovered in all my interviews that many people are really excited about the skills question, you first have the gig-related skills. So really, the skills that are related to the work you did, which is easy for platforms that only do one kind of work, but really hard for platforms that are really kind of competing with temp agencies and offer different kind of works, but also the platform work related skills. So what skills you need to have to work, to be able to work via a platform. And together with the Dutch TNO, don't try to read it all, you will get the slides later in a link. We really made a short text based on different articles. Okay, what are the skills that are used to be able to work via platform, not really looking at what work you are doing on your platform. And I think from that perspective, it's also really interesting to see, okay, so what are those variables involved? Of course, there were others that already tried to do something with the portability. There were quite some startups that tried to tackle the problem of, okay, can we also make a kind of an independent data wallet for gig workers? So here are some names of some companies that tried, and they all failed because it's really hard. So, but they tried some really interesting things of combining different data as well from the platform or as well from other data sources to create a kind of a trust profile for the worker. Because also the data profile of workers is nice to take with you to other platforms or also to another non-platform employee. Because what you also see with platform work is that most platform workers, they have really troubles in getting the first transactions because of the what they call newbie dilemma. So you have no reputation on the platform, so you don't get any jobs for that, and this could contribute to that. Some other examples. I've analyzed all these cases and I have some lessons learned. I think the first one is a lack of focus. So they were really just focusing on all marketplaces, so e-commerce, sharing economy, gig economy, everything. There's a really big chicken egg problem. So how can you get critical mass? Because you need to have the platform worker, the gig worker, but also the platforms to implement the score. And it's really hard to realize when you are an outside party. Talking about data sharing gets complex in probably 5 seconds after talking to a data sharing expert. So how to avoid these complex processes? Because these complex processes also really lead to a challenge in finding business model, because with complexity also comes big cost. I think also timing, most of them, they were really, really, really early. And also looking at the business model, most initiatives, they really focus on aggregating data for grip on pay or getting data risk scores for financial products like insurance of loans. So most business models or business models they want to use was also to generate data to create a more trust profile to get risk scores for financial products. There are also some examples from platforms that also try this. So also the example of Glovo will be also be presented in the in the panel discussion, but also Uber also did the same in Netherlands and in the UK. So as a Uber taxi driver, you could download your data in a CV. They call it a reference letter, and then Adecco. It's a temp agency, and Uber is also a client of Adecco. And Adecco, they made a landing page where you, as a Uber driver, could go to get some work. They started this when COVID started, and the demand on Uber made a freefall of 80%. So there was a really need for people to reschedule and also to get other work. I think the conclusion. I think what you also can see also after research, and as I mentioned, the report, I will share the link later in the chat, it looks like the portability of data has some contribution to the position of the worker. But I think we need lots more research also to validate, but also the contributions of Judith and also of Jeroen will also elaborate on that. This data could be used for multi-homing between platforms, but also as a proof of work for the non-platform labor markets and to also enrich upcoming career wallets. Because what I also saw is that there are quite some new initiatives around career wallets. So there are personal wallets for workers when they can have their skills, their ID, their diplomas. And I think also the gig data can also really be a good data source for these career wallets. So there are many questions. And I think the only way to find out is by trying. And I will also at the end of this session also will give some insights in what we're going to do about that, because we're going to really build this into practice, or we're already building it. Gig economy is a digital first economy, a good playground to experiments, because platforms, they really have a digital first approach. But in the end, I think all stakeholders in labor markets need to move with that. It's also why I also really speak to temp agencies, because they also have much data on the worker they can share for the good of the worker. Because in the end, I think in this new period of time we're living, a lock-in based on not sharing data is a really weak model. And also a missed opportunity with the regulation on GDPR in mind. And I think in the end also this sharing data, it is possible as long as you want to go forwards. And yes, it's scary. Yes, it will have influence on your current business model. But I think then the question also for the companies is also, do you want to lead or do you want to follow? Originally in the program, it was called Closing Remarks and Future Plans. So I was free to swap them, because I think it's more interesting to first look at the future plans, because yes, now there is a report and it was really hard to say, okay, at what moment am I going to stop the research report and start with the next chapter. So that is today. And I'm really proud of that, and also really happy that everybody with then contribute to it. So because the report gave insights, but I think we need to also start to get the discussion forward and then validate assumptions and learn how we can use data to empower the worker in the gig economy. So short, it's time for action. So this is what we're going to do right now. So this is also the next phase of the research is that it's going to be from a research to a pilot. It's called a gig CV or plus CV in Dutch. And this is a screenshot of the website. So in the end, every platform worker a personal gig CV, where I think it's really important to mention that we're not going to combine data. So we're going to let it into silos. So for the future plans, the focus will be on the top right corner of this picture. So the on-location work where the clients choose the worker with a focus on home cleaning, babysitting, and all kind of work is normally being matched by also temp agencies. So what we did is during the research, there was a research workshop October last year. There were 13 different platform owners there, and then quite some people were really open to share data. So I thought, okay, maybe we can already start with the next phase. So what we did was first gather some gig platforms that are willing to share their data, because in the end, you always need to start with people that want to do something and ignore people that don't want to do something, of course. And let's keep the positive vibe in that. Also added some scientists you also partly saw today to also validate the assumptions and validate experiences by scientific research on a way that on short term, we would get the research insights from a practical way, and then long term also to contribute to the academic debates. Also to add some knowledge partners to the project. So ICT-Recht, it's a Dutch legal firm, and Freshheads, it's a Dutch technology and design firm, because in the end, you really need to have all the disciplines on board. And also some funding partners. So we got a grant by winning a inclusive platform work challenge by NSVP and SBCM, but also the platform, they also contribute in finance, because this is also really shows put your money where your mouth is. And also I did quite some investments in my time. I'm happy to contribute and sponsor in that. So there was a question also in the chat from, okay, but based on which variables do you decide what data to share? So this is also a oversight of the research I did together with Jeroen, where you also ask the platform workers, okay, what data do you want to share? So this is the results on that, where there were 1114 different platform workers responding on that. So here are some lists of data we're going to take, platform workers can take with them. I think it's really important to say we only use data generated via the platform, because then you know it's really true. So we don't let people give the option of adding other data, because this is the data you can verify. So we decided not to also take it into the CV. Of course, in such a process of data sharing, is that there are some challenges. I think the first one is how to avoid complexity in money, process, and technology. How do you create a standard that fits for all platforms? Because there are many different kind of platforms, and also the communication and the process is also a challenge. So how to avoid that? I think the complexity problem is avoid sending data from A to B as much as possible. No central data storage and almost no money involved, because I think also money involved also really contributes to complexity. So we try to do as less data sharing from A to B as possible, and all data is in verticals, so no combination of data and building trusted third parties, because it makes things complex and expensive. The second one is the standards, a combination of fixed and flexible data points and a PDF generated that can put all variables into a nice design. So because some platforms, they measure different kind of things about worker than others. And the communication process, I think, be patient, be persistent, and then in the end, everything will be all right. And it will also be all right. So at December 15, we will launch in Netherlands GigCV CluCV, where six platforms have implemented the standards, and over 50,000 gig workers then can download their data for free in a nicely signed PDF. I really added this for free on purpose, because in other presentation, people, they were thinking, oh, so you're going to make money from the gig workers. No, they just can download it for free on the platform they are working via. So this is some nice technical stuff, but in the end, this is just a mock-up. They will be able to download their data within this this nice designed CV. After the launch, I'm going to look for much media attention, also international, not for my own ego, but in the end, really to show that it is possible to collaborate together and share data. Because I think many initiatives, they don't start because people are saying, okay, but is it possible to collaborate with platforms and they're not going to share data? So now we showed it's possible. So now people don't have the excuse of not doing things because they have that excuse. Really practical Dutch approach, I guess. The second part will also the publication of the standards open, and then also ask other platforms to join. There are already in Netherlands 8 other platforms that also want to join GigCV after the launch. And I'm also talking to platforms in different countries to see if they can also share the data via the same standards. Then also next year, research with the city of, because cities and communications, they are quite slow. So I'm still having many conversations with them. But in the end, we need to see, okay, can this PDF that we generate, so the export of the data of the worker into a digital CV, will it also grow the opportunity for access for non-platform work? So that's also research we're also going to do next year. And then also explore the next phase for further development of the standards. One thing could also be an import function for platforms or career wallets, and also see how we can add skills or other objective data to the CV. Because I also really like the comment of Philly about, okay, but are you not going to, so are you going to ignore your bad ratings? I think in the end, ratings are just a really small part of a reputation profile. So it would be much more interesting to get much more objective data. So like, what skills did you use to the gig CV? Because I think also in the future, the relevance of these stars will be less big, or I hope. So last slide, I think my main goal and ambition is, I think, to show within a new case that data sharing is possible. Because many discussions stop with the wish of data sharing, not with the actual data sharing, to help also this development discussion further, and also to contribute to the discussion. And my goal is not to become the biggest, because there's nothing to sell. Because in the end, the nice thing about the standard is that everybody can copy it. So the technology behind GigCV, we put quite some work in it, but of course it's not unique. So if people in other countries want to copy it and do it themselves, be my guest. Because my main goal is then that others are going to start experimenting with data sharing in the end for the good of the worker. So that's also my ambition in this project.